contains sexually oriented content.
Ooh. Love Line. Viewer discretion advised.
What should we do?
Hey, welcome to Loveline. Tonight, our special guest is the cast of Oh, Grow Up. I'm Catherine McCourt, and here are the boys, Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
The Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew's a board certified physician.
Yeah. Yada, yada, yada.
An addiction medicine specialist. That's Catherine McCourt. And tonight, our guests, guests are from the ABC show, Oh, Grow Up. So, without any further delay,
fantastic.
Let's start the show. Susie and Mike are in the studio.
My girlfriend here, Susie, she wants to get a boob job, and I think she looks great. She's beautiful, nice body, great legs. I think it's an unnecessary risk. I've read people have died from it, you know, things like that. It's just an unsuspect waste of money. I think it's dumb.
Let's hear from Susie. What about Susie's point of view?
I want bigger boobs. I think it would look better with them. I've wanted them for a while, so.
Susie, why do you want bigger boobs? I mean, is there?
I don't like the way my body looks right now with Adam.
So if it's an insecurity thing.
A little bit, but you know.
Yeah, but your boyfriend likes you the way you are. I mean.
Yeah, but she doesn't like the way she is.
Oh, who cares? You know, listen. that's a lesson to all of you, especially your kids at home. You only judge yourself based on other people's opinions, all right? Well, let's face it. Come on, Drew. If I put these shoes on, if they look like crap, I take them off and put another pair on. Well, I don't care what I think they look like. I care what everyone else thinks.
You know, I was talking to somebody today about almost this exact issue. They were talking about that aphorism that was around in the 70s where, hey, you got to love yourself first.
Oh, screw that.
It's like, hey, no, you got to be love somebody else and be connected with them before you even have a self.
Well, let me tell you how you love yourself. You get up a whole bunch of other people to love you. Then you start coming around.
That's right. Susie, I don't think a boob job's necessarily going to, like, answer all your, you know, prayers for insecurity. But if it's something she wants, you know, Mike hopefully will support her.
Yeah, it's her body. You're right, there are risks. It's like any surgery. There can be bleeding, infection. The risks of anesthesia are real. But obviously these things are done frequently, and it's up to her ultimately, Mike. So it's great that you like her the way she is. I mean, at least she knows she clearly has somebody who just loves her, and she couldn't ask for more than that. So
yeah.
Let's say thanks, Drew.
It's a very interesting strategy on Mike's part. I like you. That's good thinking, kid.
Tell her you don't want that?
Yeah, don't do it. Don't get the big, voluptuous, beautiful boob job, honey, because I dig you the way you are.
Don't ask me for any money.
Yeah. Now, could you keep your sweater on? All right. Ricky is on the phone. He's 18 years old. Ricky?
Okay. I have this roommate, and he masturbates so much that it's completely out of control. He does it every morning in the shower before I go in. He does it. When my friends come over, he goes upstairs and he does it loudly so that they can hear him. My friends go upstairs and they see him masturbating. It's disgusting. He did it during the MTV Awards a couple weeks ago. He did it during Stephen King 3 nights ago. What kind of crap is that?
My girlfriend
came over. She sees him masturbating. She threatened to dump me because I can't control his problem. So how can I handle our relationship?
Wait a minute. Where is he doing this? I mean, how
in
do you
my apartment at the university.
How can you hear him doing it?
How do you know
that?
Yeah.
Go?
It's like such a small apartment. He'll go in his room and the door stays open and he'll start, And then one of my friends goes upstairs.
Oh, please. Ricky, come on. He doesn't leave the door open and groan.
Oh, the guy's a pervert.
No, he does not do that.
No, he does. If you live with him, it's disgusting.
I'm moving in with him just to prove you wrong. I'm going to leave my palatial Hollywood estate in the hills and come down and live in that dump with the rust-colored carpet you guys are squatting in.
In Waco.
Just, yeah, the Branch Davidian condo you guys are in, just to prove you wrong. All right. I don't know. You're going to have to tell the guy something. Create some boundaries.
I've talked to him about it twice.
Yeah. That masturbating in the shower is against some sort of Geneva convention because, true story, when I was in Seattle with, I don't want to say the guy's full name, but Jimmy, my other partner.
Jimmy Kimmel.
Jimmy Kimmel. And
as in the man show.
Yes.
This is a few years ago, and we were in Seattle for the Final Four working with K-Rock Radio, and we were sharing the same motel room.
Uh-oh.
He'd got done taking a long shower in the morning. The drain didn't have the action on it that you'd like. I was standing in the shower 10 minutes later in shin-deep water, and he bangs on the door and goes, "Hey, up in there, I hope you're cool." Like, yeah, okay, great. Fantastic.
This is an Emmy Award-winning Jimmy Kimmel.
Emmy Award-winning Jimmy Kimmel,
and he's
everybody.
He's so happy this is now on national television.
Oh, man. I was like, my God, my shin's pregnant now. That was a whole month in therapy just dedicated
to
that. You understand?
I'm thinking about checking in. Just
All right. Let's move forward with the show. I hope they cut that out. Jimmy's going to be pissed if he says it. Let's bring out the cast of Oh, Grow Up. Stephen Dunham, David Allen Bache, Rena Sofer, and John Ducey.
Basketball injury.
Come on.
Oh, look how much so much better looking the network people are. You know what I mean? I suppose to the cable phone. Right? I mean, it was like, wow, you guys are a network. Look at you.
All right.
That's nice. What's it like being over there on network?
What's it like being so good looking?
Yeah. No, network.
John.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah,
John.
David.
All right, I don't want to embarrass you, but the show I was reading in the bio, I didn't know about this, was written or created by the same guy who did American Beauty.
He wrote it.
Yeah. Alan Ball. Yeah.
Now, he wrote the pilot, basically, or the...
He created the pilot.
He's the executive producer and the creator of the show, yeah.
And does he write on each and
every
episode?
Every single episode.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very hands-on.
Wow, that's, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
All right, so explain the relationship for us.
Yeah, basically, I am sort of the head of the household, I guess. But that's kind of a misnomer based on the fact that I don't know what I'm doing and I'm really immature and I just haven't grown up at all. Perfect. And these are my two roommates.
These two guys.
What'd you do to your pinky, by the way?
Basketball? Bar fight.
Really?
Or softball. Whichever story works best.
Weren't you just talking about something
sounds cooler?
Something in the shower.
Yeah, something in your roommate's shower.
Yeah.
But I'm the wife of this guy.
Right.
And he, his character is gay, and so I have issues with that.
Right.
So
we decided to let him move back in with us,
right.
His old college buddies at the last
You got layers
Hilarity
on this show.
And then there's one person who's not here, Nisha Trout, and she plays his 18-year-old illegitimate daughter.
Who shows up on your doorstep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, that's same show we got here.
That's right.
Yeah.
All right, let's all jump in on some of these calls. Kelly?
Hi. After my husband and I have sex, my husband brings our chihuahua up on our bed, and he lets it lick his penis off.
Oh. Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
When I try talking to him about it, he just shrugs it off.
So to speak.
Yeah, and
what do you want from us?
Well, I'm wondering how I can... I don't know, help him get over this kind of obsession that he has going on here.
Stop having sex with him if he's going to keep doing this.
Right. Okay.
Or kill the dog.
Simple enough.
Or order a lot of Taco Bell.
But preferably not that. I mean, look, this is bizarre behavior.
He does this in front of you? He doesn't...
Yeah.
Does he think this is like a sexy thing, or is he laughing the whole time?
Well, he's smiling. It's like he's enjoying it.
And have you told him that it bothers you?
Yeah, I did.
And he keeps doing it.
Yeah.
Is he enjoying it more than the actual sex he's having with you? Because that's really a problem.
He usually does it after he orgasms.
Kelly, this is bizarre. Come on. You got to just set down a few rules in the household, would you say?
That I wouldn't even let the dog on the bed. I mean, much less the licking of the penis.
Or in the state.
You know, here's how you do.
This is not a big dog.
You get one of the squirt guns, and each time the dog licks your husband's penis, you squirt it with the squirt gun to try to train the dog.
The husband.
The husband. That is bizarre.
Yeah.
I don't like chihuahuas, as a matter of fact, so I don't have a big problem with that.
They're mean, they bite. They're mean, they bite. You imagine.
They're the world's crappiest dogs. Really. They got those big beady eyes, and they're yapping all the time.
Well, now we know they're good for something.
How do you breed them for that?
Apparently.
This now is Joe. Joe, what's going on?
Since approximately the age of 13, I've had an increasing interest in child pornography and discussing fantasies via the Internet. I have a strong attraction to females around the age of 4 and up, and am in fear of losing control of myself and possibly acting on these fantasies.
Did something happen to you when you were that age?
No, I've searched my past, and I wasn't able to find anything that would justify my neurosis.
Well, yeah, just the way you're talking, though, is something's going on.
Huh.
All right, you're how old now?
15.
And tell us about your past and all. Is there anything there that we should know about?
Nothing at all. My parents are kind people. No way could have perpetrated such things.
Yeah, we're not necessarily saying they did. They never physically were aggressive with you or anything like that?
No, none of that.
So when did you become interested in this?
About 13.
And puberty.
Can this be genetic?
Yeah, that was one of my questions. Could it be genetic predisposition?
This is sort of an aberrant preoccupation. In my experience, I've never seen it without there being some history of sexual abuse or some sort of trauma at that age that you're trying to sort of resurrect, get back to.
Well, do you consider yourself dangerous?
Increasingly, yes. I think I might be losing control of myself. I have waves of panic attacks occasionally, and I just feel unable to control myself, and it scares me.
All right, so what should he do?
Well, why don't you get some treatment, Joe?
You got to cut your penis off, Joe. It's cursed.
Can't you self-commit? I mean, can't he go someplace and commit himself if he can't?
Well, he's not know about committed, but he can go to have some treatment.
He's having some panic attacks.
Well, if he's concerned that he might act on it, there are kids out there that could be at risk.
Absolutely, and that's why it's incumbent upon him to get some treatment. Somebody needs to be helping him with this and supervising him. Less, Joe, you become a criminal, right?
Yeah. Well, where could I go for some anonymous sort of?
It's not anonymous. You need to be. You haven't done anything yet, is that right?
Right.
So you need to see a mental health professional. You need to go in and talk to somebody. Okay. If you have a doctor, ask for a referral from your doctor. But Joe, just think about it as being first of all, your own discomfort can be helped, but B, you're on the verge of harming a lot of people, or maybe not a lot, but you're going to harm somebody.
Right.
And you got to do something about this before that happens. Plus, it sounds like in general, you've got a lot of other stuff kind of going on. You don't sound like you're particularly happy right now, right?
Right.
And that can be dealt with. There's no reason you shouldn't be, and you can be treated and managed, and whatever is going on here can be taken care of, all right?
All righty.
All right, so do something before you do something,
right,
basically, exactly. Is what we're saying. Okay. Yeah.
Is there something else? Something bigger going on there?
Sorry.
Yes. Okay. Austin, you're 25.
Yeah, I have some type of sexual dysfunction.
Perfect.
ever since I was, I'd say, about 14, 15 years old, I ejaculate way too quickly. And I was at work a couple weeks ago, and I had one of my girlfriends come visit me during lunch, and we went to the back room and locked the door, and we got busy. And sure enough, after about a minute and a half, I did my thing. But I decided to do something a little different. I put my thumb over the tip of my penis to try to stop my semen from coming out.
Austin?
Yes.
Why?
A friend of mine told me that it might be able to, you might be able to keep it back so you...
See, what a disaster. What a mess it must have made.
So you can go longer.
Imagine a poor janitor coming in there. Hey, somebody spilled some coffee or toner. Oh, no, what is...
And it didn't work. It didn't work. It went shooting out, and kind of like a hose when you So it was done over with a minute and a half later. And so I was just wondering, first of all, ever since then, I have to, whenever I have sex now, my testicles itch really, really badly. And when I ejaculate, I only have a small amount of semen come out of my penis. And I'm wondering if I did some type of harm and whether or not I can take some type of medication to make me last longer when I have sex.
All right. These are all very good questions. We will take a break, and then we'll all converge on your penis.
This. I knew MTV was in partnership with the devil.
Log on to lovelineonline.com. Please include your phone number with the area code.
All right, we're back with more Loveline with the cast of Oh Grow Up, Wednesday nights, 9:30 on ABC. And when we left off, we're speaking to Austin. Austin has one of his girlfriends come over to work so we can have sex with her in the back room. If I owned a business, I would fill that back room with sand. That's the first thing I'd do, because like all sorts of nonsense going on back there.
Absolutely.
I would pull the door off the thing. I wouldn't, there's always someone doing something in the back room. I'd eliminate that back room. That'd be my office.
Oh, boy.
Then I'd be doing the weird stuff.
That's right.
Right. So you had sex with one of your girlfriends in the back room. You had an orgasm in your usual minute and a half, but this time you did something different. You put your thumb over the end of your urethra, and now you're having trouble, pain. Yeah. Your scrotum itches when you're having sex.
No, aches.
Testicles itch when I have sex.
You said itch.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Well, you can't hold off for 45 seconds, a minute, not scratch them.
No, well, I try not to scratch them just because it's kind of embarrassing.
Right. All right.
But they always
compared
scratch.
Compared to the thumb thing.
Or they always did.
All right, Austin, how long ago did this happen?
This happened about 2 weeks ago.
The finger over the tip thing?
Yes.
Okay. You've done something, okay? What, I can't say. You may have just caused an irritation of the prostate. You may have caused some disturbance of the urethra, a tear, or God knows, some sort of irritation in the urethra. Does it hurt when you pee at all?
No.
And do you spray? Do you have split streams or anything like that when you urinate?
No.
Okay. And
Everyone does that.
But I mean, right? Yeah.
You guys know
that's perfectly
about?
Normal, isn't it?
Like, you ever stand there, you're standing right in front of the toilet, and the urine's going like that. Like, you're like, hey, I'm screwed, man. I don't know. And then, like, so you'll go, all right. You'll, like, turn this way. And then right when you adjust, it straightens out. And it's, you know, all over the magazine rack or the, you know, the bathrobe. Or, but
just
why do you
right
get that
the
in the morning? Why in the morning for that?
Don't know.
No. You call yourself a doctor. All right, so anytime you do something and stop yourself,
yeah, when your body,
when your body begins a process.
Right, generally that's not a good thing to do. And you can hurt yourself, but not badly. It's not like you have to worry there's some awful problem. But it is time to see a urologist. It may just be some prostate inflammation or something like that, or something called epididymitis. But do get it looked into, okay?
Sounds right.
Yeah. Rob is 19. Rob? Hey, Rob.
Yeah.
What's going on?
My brothers, they've been into heavy drugs lately. My oldest brother, he's doing heroin, and my middle-aged brother is doing cocaine. And the other night, they got in a fight about this girl, and I told my mom about the drug problem that they've been having, and then my mom told my brothers that I told her, and now my brothers won't talk to me, they won't talk to my mom. I've tried calling them. They got caller ID. They won't answer the
Look,
phone.
Look, Rob, you may have begun the process that will save their lives.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
So, what do you feel guilty about? What can you say? Heroin, the probability of dying from heroin addiction is very high.
Yeah, and that's, now they think that I did it to hurt them, but in my mind, you know, I did it because I love my brothers and I don't want them. They don't need that, you know?
Look, they're in their disease right now. Don't worry about what they're thinking. Just you've got to get at them. You've got to find a way to leverage them into treatment. Don't even think about how they react. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
They're on drugs. They're going to react all over the place.
Well, what do you want them to do, though?
You've got to keep the pressure on. You've got to keep creating consequences for their drug use. Try to find ways, whatever leverage you have with them or your parents have with them, try to get them into some kind of treatment because their probability of dying from this is substantial.
Yeah, that's what I think, too.
Do your parents have any leverage with them? Do they have any financial...
Well, like my mom, as soon as I told her, she's like, well, I have no respect for him and this and that, but I'm like... I think that's the wrong thing she should do. I think she should be there regardless because, you know, that's her children. And to just cut them off, that's just going to make them want to do it more, I think. And if she talks to them and says, hey, you know, look, we're really worried about you or whatever, that might make them think. But
I agree with you. And wherever you have opportunities to confront them with their behavior, you got to do it.
Yeah.
And maybe, do you have an opportunity to do an intervention on them? Is that something you could put together?
They have a group discount rate they offer for those
family
interventions.
Rates? Oh.
Yeah, family rate. I'm going to swing by my brother Chet's house, and then Larry, he's right on the way. So, you know, I mean, it's usually $1,500 a pop, but how about $2,000 for both of them?
I don't think so.
You don't do that? It makes sense, though.
It does make sense, but who knows. Rob, it sounds like your head's in the right place with this. Kind of keep at it, okay?
Yeah.
Robert, 15. Robert?
About 2 months ago, my parents caught me downloading porno on the internet, and I got in some serious trouble for it. And when I went on the computer recently, after my dad was on, I found some foreign websites and pictures under, like, recent files. And I know if my mom finds it, that I'll get in trouble again, and she'll blame me for it. So what do I do? Do I, like, walk up to my dad and go, hey, how's that porn, you know?
No, you ask for a new car. I mean,
yeah.
That's a leverage.
Hey, Dad, my ass is getting pretty sore from that moped you got me in 91.
That's right.
I need some wheels, four of them.
That's right.
Yeah, but I mean, like, it's kind of sick, you know? I mean, yeah. I don't want to find, like, stains on the carpet after my dad's on the computer.
It's no more sick than him doing it, though.
Yeah. Well, you know, like, father, like son. You think he's just jacking around. You don't think he's serious.
No.
Why? Because whenever someone makes a joke about...
But something that would be disturbing to them, you know, it's...
Yeah, but sometimes maybe they're nervous or something and they're...
All right, well, answer it as though it were real.
Well, I don't know what his mom does if she snoops on the computer.
I think he just stays out of it. Yeah. If she finds it, he denies it and, you know, then deals with it at that point.
And can you blame any 15-year-old these days from hopping on a computer and going nuts with that stuff?
No.
I mean, seriously.
Hope you don't blame a 30-year-old for doing that.
I mean,
we're all in big trouble.
Imagine having access to that world at 15. You know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah, as compared to when we were 15.
Yeah, like I had we had to take a piece of bark and with charcoal draw a topless woman on it. And we'd all, like, you know, meet in some cave and hold a torch up to it. And, you know. They don't have all this fetish websites and everything. Well, at least I'd know how to work a computer. That'd be one, it'd be the good part. All right.
Let's go on. Sarah's 19. Sarah.
Yeah, I have never had sexual intercourse before. And when I have tried to have sex, my vagina tightens up. And then I tense up and I can't get into it. And then I get the same feeling when I try to insert a tampon. And my boyfriend and I are really frustrated by this. And I want to know what's, like, causing this.
It's called vaginismus. It's something that some women get when they're nervous and anxious, particularly in an intimate relationship. It's a spasm of the floor of the pelvis, the muscle spasm. And it can be intense and it can be painful even. So it's something that you ought to talk to your doctors about. I mean, the treatments are, there are various ways that people can approach it, but the primary issue is trying to learn how to relax.
Before the sex or during the sex?
It's before it happens. It's like, it's not the hymen. It's not like inside the vagina. It's like the opening to the vagina. Like if there's any pressure on there, there's no sharp pains, but it makes me feel really uncomfortable. And I tense up really bad. Even though I'm relaxed and, like, ready to have sex, I can't.
And even with the tampon?
Yeah, with a tampon, even just like the head of the tampon trying to go into the vagina, like it hurts because there's pressure on the outside and it bothers me.
Is there anything about your history we need to know?
Back when I was a freshman in high school, I was on a date with this guy, and he tried to force rape on me.
Have you dealt with that? Have you gone to any rape counseling?
Well, I've dealt with it in some ways, but...
Pushing it out of your awareness is not a way of dealing with it.
Unless you're supplementing that with alcohol, in which case it's a viable therapeutic technique.
Yeah, that's what I do all the time.
That's what we do. Yeah. Are you supplementing it with alcohol, Sarah?
No, I'm not.
No. Okay, then. Now that's a problem.
No, I just like want to know if there's like subconscious reasons, like if he when he tried to force himself on me, if there's like something subconsciously why I tense up because.
Hold on. Let's all think about it.
Panel says yes.
Sarah, are you in college now?
Yes, I am.
Junior college, is it?
Sophomore.
Junior college, though?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. See, I know junior college thinking when I hear it. All right, Sarah, you I don't know, get a little therapy.
Well, so even biofeedback, there are all kinds of ways it can be approached, but it is something that needs to be sort of looked at as a problem that can probably be dealt with pretty easily. And you may find that there's some issues left over from that rape that you need to deal with as well. So.
Well, it was an attempted rape.
Right. He never actually raped me, but he tried to force himself upon me.
Right. Then what happened? He sort of...
I guess I blocked it out. I didn't really know what to think. I don't know.
Yeah. But did you stop him? You got out of the car?
Yeah, I stopped him. Yeah, I did stop him.
Blocking
did
it out.
Did you run away or something?
No, I just stopped him and I told him I had to go and, you know, I said that my mom would be calling and he knew then that he just stopped and he's just like, oh, okay.
And did he drive you home?
No, I drove myself over to his house and I drove back home.
Oh, okay.
Blocking out of awareness is not dealing with it, okay?
Right.
All right. And you wonder if something happened before that.
Yeah, you do.
Because not a great situation to be in, but it doesn't sound like the guy, you know, made a strong move. She pushed him off and left, essentially.
Guardian?
Yes.
What's up?
Nothing much. I have a question.
Just wanted to call and chat.
See you. Love your show.
Okay.
A couple of weeks ago, I had a sexual encounter with a girl. And I'm HIV positive, and I've been on the cocktail for 3 years. I've been HIV positive since June of 86. And I accidentally ejaculated into her mouth, and I'm wondering, is she going to come down with the virus, or are there any steps that she can use to prevent it?
Oh, boy. He said he was positive since 86?
No, for 3 years.
He's been on the cocktail for 3 years. I didn't hear what he said in terms of...
Oh, all right. I'm going to take a shower and sink my feet into a bucket of ice, and then we'll come back
Ooh,
with
hair.
The Guardian.
Oh, feel that?
Catch an all
civil tension.
Ron Livingston.
Tara Reid. You're watching Loveline on MTV.
Or you're in the bathroom.
Hey, if you have any questions, call us 24 hours a day. 323-520-LOVE. Long distance charges may apply.
All right, we have returned with Stephen, David Wayne, and John All from Oh Grow Up Wednesday nights, 9:30 on ABC. And Guardian is. Phoned in with a pretty disturbing question, but he's HIV positive. He's been on the triple cocktail thing for 3 years.
3 years.
Do you know what your viral load is?
Greater than 50,000.
So in spite of the cocktail, you're still producing a lot
it's
of virus.
It's not the full cocktail.
How come?
It's only Combivir and Viramune, if you're familiar.
How come you're not taking everything?
Because I haven't been able to get it down to a doctor to get the full cocktail through.
And even though you know your viral load is up?
It's up, yes.
Why don't you got, I mean, what could be more important, right?
How long have you had it?
Oh, gosh, June of 86? What does that make
that's
it?
That's what I thought he said.
That's great. Well, that's what AIDS is now. HIV,
great.
it's become
it's
a chronic.
It's not that great.
No, 13. It's great that he's, it's not that great, yes, it's, but it's great that he's doing fine after 14 years.
Guardian, how did you contract AIDS when you were 9?
Blood.
During the hemophilia catastrophe. I'm a hemophiliac.
All right, yeah. So, hey, Guardian.
Yes.
First off, what kind of name is Guardian for someone who has HIV and is ejaculating in someone's mouth? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's a horrible name for someone who does
that. It's derivative from my real name.
Okay.
Mr. Carolla. I like the way you refers to you.
So far, outside of DMV, I've never actually been called
Did
that.
She know that he was HIV positive?
She did. Well, she didn't at the time, but she does now.
Okay.
Is she freaking out completely?
No, she wasn't. She was surprisingly calm. No.
Has she been tested?
No, she has not yet.
What are you thinking about, though, having unprotected sex?
Like I said, things got rather out of control. I had a few beers to drink.
All right, but Guardian, because your viral load is up, you are infectious, right?
Yes.
And you know that ejaculate, when it passes through the mouth, can cause viruses liable to penetrate the esophagus and get in that way. So one of the things that she can do, there are post-exposure treatments. They use this in healthcare providers, health workers who get needle sticks and that sort of thing. And they've actually shown some pretty good results with getting on antiviral therapies right away. So she ought to go to an infectious disease doctor or her doctor, if he's aware of these programs, and to get on some medication right now to see if you can prevent this from becoming an infection. That's what he's doing. And then he needs to get on the appropriate therapy. I don't know if everybody's aware, but suppressing the viral loads down to undetectable are highly correlated with preventing the progression of HIV to AIDS. So.
But I thought if somebody has the HIV virus and it's, say they ejaculate in somebody's mouth, once it hits the air, I thought that it kills the virus.
No. The mouth is an inhospitable environment, but as it goes down, it can get through that way. And if there are open sores in the mouth.
Yeah.
No, it can oral sex is a potential transmission.
Mm-hmm. All right, but let's not all stop oral sex. Let's just finish not saying that.
And have some air.
That's right.
That's what we need.
Create an oxygen buffer between the penis and the mouth.
Right? Hit the air,
I totally agree.
This now is Andy. Oh, via TV phone. All right, Adam.
Yeah, it's my favorite.
Andy's he's 19, he's at BU.
He watch the screen.
Andy?
Hello?
Hey.
Hi. When I have sex with my girlfriend with a condom, everything's great, it's fine. But when I don't, it's great again, but afterwards, she cramps up, like, really bad.
She cramps up?
Yeah, she cramps up, and she explains it, like, it's all internal, like, and sometimes she explains it from her uterus all the way up into, her chest.
Wow.
And it's at different degrees every time, but it always falls along the lines of whether we use a condom or not. And she's on the pill, so we're never really sure what to do. But I want to know.
Why do you use the condom when you use it?
She's still a little paranoid. She brought it up a while ago. It makes her feel more comfortable.
Well, I wonder if she's got something else going on. Because clearly the semen is irritating something in her genital tract. And what I would think of is something like a cervicitis, where the cervix is inflamed, like herpes or things like that can. Or even maybe some sort of chronic vaginal infection. I mean, she may have something maybe she's not telling you about, or maybe she doesn't know about it. And she's seen a doctor about this?
No, she seems like a really sweet girl. She hasn't seen a doctor.
Only evil chicks. I think that's clear. I think that the data backs that up. There's some sort of stepmother, some evil stepmother in order to get herpes.
Well, you've read the literature.
She's true. We are... I tell you, I got a high threshold for the semen discussion, but I'm just about topped off with the semen. Like I'm up to here with semen. This show's been nothing but semen. You know, I feel like I've been dipped in semen and rolled in breadcrumbs or something.
Yeah. Scoot down a bit.
Yeah.
Nice. Oh, God. But, Andy, she obviously needs to see a doctor, have a pelvic examination, right? I mean, you're not going to know what
this
is.
You think it's something related to the semen, then, because it falls along the lines of condom or not?
It seems to me, but there's nothing about semen per se, unless she has already some chronic inflammation or something going on in there.
But it'd be something like physical, not psychological.
Oh, yeah, I think so.
Okay, she could have something and possibly be hiding it from him
or
protecting.
Yeah.
You by saying, please wear a condom.
Yeah.
Is there any possibility that when they're using a condom, if it's a lubricated condom, that she is then more comfortable, but when they're not using a condom...
Yeah, but to have that kind of visceral pain going up into her chest, whatnot, I mean, that is higher up the genital tract than just the vagina, so something's going on, and that needs to be looked at.
All right, so just go to the on-campus, whatever, and put her up on the rack.
Now is Ann.
Ann is 18.
Ann?
Hey, yeah, I went clubbing a couple weeks ago with some friends of mine, and when we got there, we met up with some friends, and by the time I was ready to leave, the guy that I was walking home with was really drunk. And I walked up with him to his room, and we kind of fooled around a little bit, and we went further than I'd planned on it. We didn't have sex because I got up and left. The next morning, he didn't remember anything, and I was kind of interested in pursuing a relationship with him, but I don't know whether or not I should tell him, because if I do tell him, it may mess up the chances for the relationship, and if I don't and he finds out later, he may get mad at me.
All right. I'll bet he knows more than she thinks, and right. he's intentionally not bringing it up, but that's a theory that we'll explore after this.
Coming up next on the 10 Spot. Say what, Carol?